Blackstone Publishing presents The Dark Fights by Alexandra Vinarov. This book is read by Lisa Zimmerman. For my parents and for my brother. Chapter 1. There are no more than 10 people in the ER waiting room. It is past 11 at night and rather quiet, New York One News humming drowsily somewhere in the background. Danilo is sitting with his eyes closed, taking careful, measured breaths. I suspect he has broken ribs, and I hope he doesn't have any internal bleeding. He cannot move his right arm. The shoulder must have been dislocated or separated. I look at his face and have to blink rapidly to control the tears. A broken nose with crusts of dried blood, huge bruises, cuts. His beautiful face is now almost unrecognizable.
It's all right,
Danilo says with difficulty. It hurts him to move his lips. He is not the type of man to withstand pain. I am not sure if it's true that some people have naturally high pain thresholds, but I do know that you can train yourself to raise your tolerance. You acknowledge the pain, take it in, and deal with it. Danny cannot do that. He feels the pain acutely and does not know how to cope with it, how to process it, and so he is suffering now. I can see it, and I wish it was I who felt the pain instead.
It's all right, he says.
Damn it, nothing is all right. I clench my fists and breathe deeply, in and out, trying to calm down. I feel so bad for Danny. I can't remember the last time I cried, and now it's all I can do to hold back the tears. But I'm also angry with him. He promised he would stay away from 2 Guild Street. When the bartender from Wolf Flanagan's pub called, saying Danilo had been dropped off there in rather bad shape and I'd better come get him, I got a cold spasm in my stomach. Wolf Flanagan's is right around the corner from 2 Guild Street. I do not believe in coincidences.
Ah, damn it.
He promised. He looked me in the eye and promised. But then again, Danilo is not the type of man who can keep his word. He never could. I have a few questions to ask him, but now is not the time. In an effort to divert my thoughts, I look around the room, take in the silent figure sitting here at this late hour. One man in particular catches my attention. He is perhaps in his 30s, has a muscular build and cropped hair. He's wearing old jeans and a fisherman's sweater. He frowns and glances at his watch every few minutes. He looks very tired, and you can tell he hates this waiting. I wonder what brought him here. Must be his hand, which looks very swollen. I bet one of the bones is broken. He glances at me several times and smiles, a weary, barely perceptible sort of smile. He then shifts his gaze to Danilo's face, frowns again, and shakes his head slightly. I lean back in the chair, close my eyes, and go back to my breathing exercises. Breathe in deeply, imagine the air moving to the back of my head, then swallow, bring it down to a point just below the navel, hold it, and then breathe out very slowly. This helps me to relax, and I probably doze off for a minute or so. The next moment, the room seems to explode with deafening shouts and chaotic movement. I'm not sure if the person causing this has just come in from the street or from the inside of the hospital. He was definitely not one of the people in the waiting room. He's a big guy in his 20s, now moving around in a frenzy, kicking chairs and screaming. He then turns toward an older woman who is sitting by herself on a cushioned bench, positioned somewhat away from the other seats. He removes a switchblade from his jeans pocket and goes straight for the woman, all the while shouting a mixture of threats and obscenities. Panicked, the woman jumps up and steps back until she is backed into a corner. Fixing my eyes on the knife, I have gotten up and moved in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.